Well, hello there. I'm Abi Palmer and welcome to The Weather, your weekly after party to celebrate the launch of my four-part series, Abi Palmer Invents the Weather, in collaboration with my two cats, Lola Lola and Cha-u-Kao. Previously on The Weather. That's right. Episode one of the series was called Rain. It explored autumn and ways to recreate the smell of rain. We collected liquid that fell from the sky on the night of the hunter moon and recycled it into a cat-sized cloud full of fermented forest floor. And let me tell you, it smelled incredible. If you haven't seen the film yet, it's available right here on Art Angel's YouTube channel until the end of March. But right now, why go anywhere? Pour yourself a drink and stick around. Now, it does look like I'm the first guest to arrive, doesn't it? But I'm sure you all have a lot of questions for both my collaborators. Let's see if we can find them. I'm taking you on a little tour. Okay, so we're first of all looking for Lola Lola. Sometimes she likes to hide out in the bathroom. Fans of Sanatorium will be excited to notice I've got a new bathtub and it's real. Super fans will be pleased to know that it's currently full of black mold. So if you like fungus, you've come to the right house. Let's have a look. Oh, it looks like I might have found someone. Excuse me, Lola. Lola, would you care to do an interview? Lola, how does it feel to be the star of Abi Palmer Invents the Weather, starring yourself and Cha-u-Kao? Huh. Okay. Do you feel that the feline representation in the film was everything you wanted and more? Not too chatty. Let's see if we can find Cha-u. Now, sometimes she likes to hide up here on top of the fridge. Let's just show you what that looks like. There's the fridge. She has a little nest up here on top. But today, no, it's just her remains. Sometimes she likes to hang out, in a little cupboard back here. Let me see if I can show you. It's a nice little cupboard. It's got some, like, if you were Harry Potter, you'd be happy to live in this cupboard. That's a little crucifix I stole from my secondary school. Over here, fans of Sanatorium again, this is a foldable bath for your bum, if you get hemorrhoids. And over here, a foldable wheelchair, bunch of crap really, but there's no cat, so I think I know where she is though. That's her thrive, and there she is. Cha-u, how are you doing? Would you care to do an interview? Cha-u, how does it feel to collaborate with your sibling on Abi Palmer Invents the Weather, starring Lola Lola and yourself? Do you feel that you captured, or do you feel that the film captured an accurate representation of what you think rain is about? Not too chatty. Let's go back to the studio. Oh, Well, hello again, my friends. It's still me, Abi Palmer, and this is still your new favourite talk show slash after party, The Weather. So right now, both my collaborators seem to be taking some kind of a nap. But don't worry, I brought a friend to join us. This week, I'm excited to introduce a guest whose work touches on the weather in some really exciting ways. I first met her, in my living room, actually. Kind of similar where to Cha-u and Lola were actually sitting. The year was 2017. We were holding a literary salon in my flat as part of the Saboteur Awards, and I'd invited all the prize nominees to come and talk about their work. Along she came and talked about this incredible digital project called The Gathering Cloud, which I've never forgotten, and I kind of want to talk about all the time, so I hope we'll get some time to chat about that today. Since then, her work has covered oceans of static, pictures of wind, and all kinds of ways to measure and document weather, climate, and the passing of time. I've got maybe a million questions for her. So let's give a big weather welcome to J.R. Carpenter. Hi, Jaya. How are you doing?
Good. How are you?
I'm okay, thank you. How's the weather?
It's raining and dark.
Ah.
As you can plainly see.
Yeah. it's a very moody backdrop, I will say. I like that in a backdrop. It adds to it. It's really miserable this week, isn't it?
Well done. You conjured it.
Thank you. Yeah, that was all me. In maybe 3 weeks' time, we'll be having a heat wave again, so don't worry.
Excellent.
I thought maybe we could start by sharing a visual description of ourselves for the audience. Would that be okay with you?
Sure. I'm a white woman with long, straight, dark hair and glasses, sitting behind a dark, shiny, bluish, shimmery curtain that looks a lot like rain in the dark.
Nice. I'm a white woman. I am dressed in a kind of fabulous raincoat getup with a green and yellow miniskirt and green rubber gloves. Behind me, there's a backdrop of more green, some cacti, and I'm laid out on a chaise longue that's pink and curvy. And just a reminder for the audience, if you've got questions for JR or myself, you can ask them on the YouTube comments thread or on Twitter via the hashtag Abi Palmer Invents the Weather. We'll be answering questions at the end of the show. So now we can actually talk. We've done all the housekeeping. How very diligent of us. It must be the rubber gloves. Do you want to talk a little bit, or is it possible if we could talk about your relationship with clouds to get us started?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I started this cloud project that you mentioned actually from trying to think about the digital cloud. And I was commissioned to do a piece for a festival that was thinking about digital spaces, and I wanted to think about digital storage and thinking about the cloud. And then I had this sort of eureka moment of the kind of level of genius that only a six-year-old can have, which was like, why do they call it the cloud? and that's how I started thinking about clouds in the sky. And I was like, well, why are they trying to call the digital cloud the cloud? Made me realize I didn't really understand the relation to clouds in the sky. So I started thinking about these two things side by each, and realizing that they are with the cloud, they're trying to make digital data storage sound ephemeral. But then I realized that clouds in the sky are not ephemeral. They're massive. They have this huge volume. So I sort of came into it, sideways like that.
Yeah, it's so interesting, isn't it? Thinking about how physical they are. I guess like in the film that has been screened this week, I was also thinking about like the weight of clouds and playing with the idea of it being something that needs to be physically pulled up into the air. And I guess like because my arms are so weak, like because of my disability, like physically pulling them up was also like a very strenuous act, and I really felt that like it's still like it, again with like that six-year-old majesty about like how do they sit there in the sky. It still blows my mind. It's such a weird, it sounds, yeah, it's like a really naive thought, but we just really, it's kind of staggering.
No, it really is. And I mean, like, I love that moment in the film where you're pulling the cloud up and you're like, this takes all my strength, because it did really show how heavy a cloud is. And although that's not technically how clouds work, but
Oh, really?
it
Oh,
sorry.
no.
But I loved how it called attention to how heavy clouds are, because and so like in my research, I realized that people just didn't know for like until the early 1900s. There wasn't even a really working early 1800s, early 19th century, there wasn't a working understanding of how clouds work. So like most of human history, clouds have been totally mysterious, and you like cracked it.
That, just in a cat-sized form, really. But
But you know.
it's really with the thing that I'm always really like, I'm actually looking, we're using the boxes from the weather show as the lighting rig for this show, and I'm looking right at the cloud one, and it's the physic, the strength, the weight of it has like they're held up with string, and then the weight of holding that in the air has created these kind of incisions in the side of the box where like the weight of it is kind of cracking the cardboard, which I always think is so interesting because they just look so effortless, clouds, don't they? And they're made of matter. It's kind of un I don't know, it's just really interesting. But yeah, I think for the last 5 years or how since you started talking about the gathering cloud, it's really changed my relationship with the digital cloud too, like thinking about the fact that it does have this physical footprint. Clouds, the fact that it's called a cloud, and it's such a vicious illusion, isn't it, to kind of to make it seem like something ephemeral and that it doesn't have an impact, but the more we're storing, the more physical space it's taking up. Yeah, I wondered if you could tell our audience a little bit about that.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I realize that they're trying to use this word cloud, the cloud, to sound ephemeral, because they're, actually data centers use a huge amount of energy, huge carbon footprint, and I think most people just think it's free, like the internet is free, it's just out there. And I realized that Facebook and Amazon and Microsoft, these big companies are, especially in the States, a lot of these data centers are still burning coal. And then they have
Great.
and then because we can't do without the digital, we can't just like cut back on the internet. We need it for everything. We need it for banking. We need it for medical. It runs everything. And so we don't really understand how it works at all. And I think the reason why I was looking at the clouds and how we started to understand the clouds is because we're sort of in a similar moment with the digital cloud, that we're using this, and but we don't really know how it works. But we could, we could start to learn about data centers. And there's been a lot. There was a lot in the news in the summer when we were having the heat waves here and the droughts, that data centers are not only burning a huge amount of electricity, but they also absorb a huge amount of water to for cooling systems. They're contributing to drought as well. And when you have these huge data centers in a locality and they're using so much energy, then they change the cost for everyone else.
Oh my God.
You know, like when taxes start to go up in a neighborhood, like because affluent people move in and then the taxes affect everybody. So they're having this huge impact on not just like the amount of energy they use to keep our data up there, but they have effects on things like the water table.
It just feels so like I was having this conversation with my brother today. We've been testing like a lot of headphones for this show because getting the sound right has been a journey, and we have a conversation. We've been having it almost every week for about 9 years about how difficult it is to get a good pair of headphones anymore. And now I have an iPhone. I do everything on my iPhone. I film on my iPhone. So it's all, everything I film is stored in the cloud. And then the new iPhones have designed themselves have been designed so as not to have a headphone jack anymore. And so you have this situation where the more technology is implemented in our life, the more complicated it becomes and the more necessary it starts to feel. The choice of not having a headphone jack has created this like sense that I don't need one and I can't use one now. And then the types of headphones that that were designed, the ones that I'm using now, I was reading some reviews and one of the reviews was saying, well, one of the flaws of them is you can't get them wet. Like you can't run with them. And so many of these like very elaborate designs, like the more technology progresses, the more it's like designed by some rich dude in California who doesn't experience rain. He doesn't experience like that kind of extreme of weather and maybe doesn't move his shoulders as much as I do. So it doesn't pick up on the rustling or maybe he doesn't, like they were saying in the reviews, they were also saying, well, they're useless for running. You can't run in them because you can't get them right. And so we have these more and more specialist little holes that we can buy products of. And there are so many products, it's almost impossible to choose. And yet they're like completely ubiquitous within a few years. You can't download the app to make these work better anymore. And there's just this like sense of everything being needed to be stored forever in the cloud, and the sense that that's meaningless, but also every tiny little decision that we're making being really consequential and then falling apart within a few years. It just feels like this kind of horror show designed by big tech that we're living in. That it just, it, when you talk about data in that way, it kind of like encapsulates this moment that we're living in. That feels quite horrifying.
Well, I think about it all the time when I'm on a train and people listen to their phones out loud.
Yeah, great, delightful.
And it's like this, the noise pollution, you know, which does pale in comparison to the carbon footprint of the cloud, but it's horrendous. It's like, you know, and yeah, all of that junk, like the planned obsolescence, you know, but one of the biggest uses of the cloud is storing backups, right? So it's like stuff we're not even using. And it's like, it's kind of like space junk.
Yeah.
and like I think of that analogy because most people think that the cloud or like the digital cloud and even like the cyberspace, like since that term cyberspace, a lot of people think that the internet is in space. But it's like in, you know, it's very physical. It's like in buildings and stuff. And yeah, it produces a huge amount of junk that like there's no there's no impetus, there's no legislation, for example, because they want these companies to, you know, bring business to the region or whatever. Yeah. So there's very little regulation.
Yeah.
I know what you mean. Like I've almost stopped listening to music because I can't even figure out where it is anymore.
Yeah, and none of us have physical CDs or I mean, if you do, even that, because we also have this, it's a double-edged problem as well, because the way we live now is so like being constantly moved from rental property to rental property, if you're not lucky enough to be a homeowner, means it's impossible to store that much crap in physical junk. So things like music, no computer even has a CD player in it anymore.
Yeah.
So we're being forced more and more to insert ourselves into the world of space junk, but it is going somewhere. I think the thing that, like, while I was doing these projects, there were kind of these moments where just the horror of the relationship between the weather and kind of the and climate has been having time to hone in on that and look at how we treat our planet has been quite horrifying. Actually, I've come to some conclusions about where my position is, but I had to go through a real period of horror and anger. I wondered if that's something, because so much of your work explores weather, like and climate as well, and I wondered if that how you've navigated that in your own life.
Without becoming suicidal.
Yeah.
Is that where you're going with this? Yeah, no, I mean, but the thing with the Gathering Cloud, for example, and I loved how you just put that, like, the kind of, what did you say, the majesty of a six-year-old? Like, the thing was to ask a quite simple question and a small question. So a lot of my interaction with these things is, well, wait a minute, how much does a cloud weigh? Like, asking these simple questions that can be a point of entry, because I think the thing is so overwhelming that people, you know, just don't want to think about it at all. And then, you know, in other projects, trying to use these, what I would call elemental media as a way of thinking through other things. So I'm working a lot on wind right now, and which is great because you can't see it. It's totally invisible. And really great for making PowerPoint presentations. Here's some wind I prepared earlier, totally invisible. So you have to think about it through other things, but it's also a way of thinking through other things. So, for example, thinking about relations between climate and the economy, right? Mm-hmm. This disposable economy that you're talking about. And I think a lot about wind in relation to the earlier age of sail, for example, and trade winds, and how colonialism and trade are so intertwined. And now we have these massive ships, container ships, moving around and around the planet. And they're not wind powered, but they're ocean powered, for example.
Yeah.
Thinking about how these elemental media like oceans and wind actually are part of the planetary system that is moving this stuff around, and they're not, you know, they're not doing it on purpose, but how our actions have actually been tied to these media for a really long time. Mm-hmm. Like, colonialism was powered by wind.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, so completely.
It's all the same wind.
Yeah.
Like, that's what does my head in. Like, it's the same, all the same ocean, all the same water is still there, and all the same wind is still there. So thinking about these kind of larger circuits of things, and I don't know where it takes me exactly, but it's like, if we're not thinking about the amount of energy we're burning with the cloud, you know, what else are we not thinking about? And how can we think through these kind of media to think about, you know, stuff that's beyond ourselves, that's bigger than ourselves?
Yeah, and starting with these, like, really small questions, it feels like a combination of, like, for me, it feels kind of essential that, like, to start with a very small question. How do you measure wind? How do you see wind? What's the weight of a cloud? How does it sit in the sky? I don't know if it's the same, but I feel like what I learned from this year was so much about, like, the necessity of smallness, like, in surviving the climate crisis emotionally as well, just thinking about the small relationships we're making with the small networks that we do have power over, because sometimes everything just feels so big, doesn't it? Like, the and some of the, like, the things that we do and don't have control over feel beyond reach. But actually, when you start with those very small questions of what can I change in my immediate vicinity, you're not going to cure climate crisis. We're on that pathway, but your own relationship with the environment and your own relationship with the world, that is an act of resistance also, to keep pushing back and to keep connecting and to find more meaning in the physical world around you. I think that feels really urgent somehow, like that's kind of what I got, like starting with this tiny little garden in my house to like building up to bigger and bigger networks. It feels really like I don't know, I always like hearing you talk about if the kind of, it feels like such an interesting combination of hard facts and poetry, because it's also very poetic, your work, isn't it? Like you look at all, I was looking again at this, I'm now really going off on three directions at once, I have lots of questions to ask, but the way in which you measure wind through language is such a big part of it too, right? Like the way you write about wind being this series of like small calculations of how it can be defined and getting bigger and bigger and bigger, like
that was a real way in, like with my wind project called This Is a Picture of Wind, the title is calling attention to that we can't see it, right? So and then the only way that we have to describe it is through language, like the Beaufort scale, which was created to for both basically for ships. Again, it's all ships, really. That's what it comes down to. And so the Beaufort scale was a way to not exactly measure wind. It was a way to observe the force of the wind. Mm-hmm. Right. And the only way to sort of codify that was through language. So as a writer, I'm thinking, like, that's really interesting, that how then can we think of wind as material, like the material of language? Mm. And I work a lot with found text, right? So I work with I'm really interested in this science writing and how. So Luke Howard, the guy that named the clouds that I worked with in The Gathering Cloud, he deferred a lot to painters, because before he came along, painters were the sort of leading authorities on clouds, landscape painters. And so he used a lot of terms like in the foreground and in the distance, and you know, these kind of landscape painter terms. And so then with wind, I'm thinking like a lot of the terms come from sailing. So crested wavelets form on inland waters, you know, and there's a guy actually, Hüller, I forget his first name at the moment, who wrote this book called Defining the Wind, and he realized that's iambic pentameter. Crested wavelets form on inland. And so there's something, and it's not Beaufort who invented that phrase, it's something that's come to us through you know, generations of like, it was eventually some weather guy in a small town somewhere who came up with that phrase. So, you know, how, I mean, in a way it's so massive and it's so beyond us, but then in another way, it's really intimate to us, you know? And I think that's a big part of my project, is trying to join these things together. Like, how can we connect our body as a weather vein, right, to these much larger systems that are much larger than us, but also like, you know, breath is also wind, you know, like we're part of this whole system, you know, micro to macro, the whole way.
And it's so, I think it's also, it's the, I don't know, there's something about breath. And I did this project a few years ago called Alchemy, which was exploring the elements and how can we explore them through language, and what happens to the metaphor in language if we change the physical sensations that are being inserted. And I also kind of went back to elemental structure. So I was looking at earth, air, wind, earth, air, water, fire, and how does, if I'm listening to a poem about fire, how does really focusing on my breath change it, for instance, or how does smelling a lip match change that, or the earth being rubbed through your hands as you're listening change the language that you're experiencing. But air was a really, it was so complicated because I was putting all these things in these tiny little boxes for people to open and engage with, and you can't, again, you can't bottle air. I tried, I thought it would be quite funny to
but it's not very compelling.
It's not very compelling, yeah. And so what we ended up doing instead was thinking about breath. So using like menthol chewing gum, and if you're chewing on menthol chewing gum or sucking on something that tastes like menthol, you really notice your breath because there's a contrast to it. So this like very icy experience happening in your mouth. But I thought it was really interesting that the only way I could find to capture air in that project was to kind of paint against it almost with something else.
I mean, the classic example though is when it's cold out and you breathe in your air, breath freezes in the air, and I love that moment because it's making like the temperature, which is also visible, is making visible something that happens all the time.
Yeah.
Right? I love how
it's mind-blowing.
Yeah,
it's
how so it weird. Reveals that to us, right? And I think that's, again, part of what I try to do with my work is to reveal something that's there all along.
Yeah. Yeah, and I love it. It's great. I at the moment, I hear you're working with fossils a little bit more and coral.
Yeah, I mean, sort of unofficially slash like trying to work it somehow to make it part of my research. But I'm a licensed mudlarker on the Thames foreshore, and before that, I was in North Yorkshire where there was a river that had a lot of coral fossils in it, and now I'm on the Thames foreshore and I'm looking for things, you know, it's. A lot of people do it for a lot of different reasons, and I'm definitely into the sort of historical man-made object. But what I get really excited about is finding something that's created, that's either a fossil or created by the more than human. I don't know if I told you, but I found a piece of Roman roof tile, right, with a cat paw print in it.
No, oh yeah. My God, that's so cool.
Yeah, so they've been great collaborators throughout, you know.
Yeah.
But that moment of like, it was a really low tide, so you've got like this tidal element, the mud, but then that like that moment of finding something that's an intersection between like this London now and this river now, and this like cat that went like touched this wet roof tile for, you know, 2 seconds, 1900 years ago.
That's crazy. That's so exciting. This like the relationship between the man-made and this like communication with non-human that's happening in so many ways. That's a really exciting thing to find.
See, I brought to show you. This is like really not made for television. This is a piece of the coral that's from the foreshore near your place in London.
In Bermondsey.
Yeah.
I love that.
Rotherhithe. And then this is a piece of this one is 340 million year old coral fossil.
Mm-hmm. And how old? Wait.
340 million.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And then this one is probably only a few hundred years old, and it would have been scooped up on a beach of some colony of the British and brought back to London as ballast in a ship.
All right. And that was sorry, carry on.
Well, deep time, right? Yeah. And colonialism.
And it's all on the same foreshore.
Well, no, this was from Yorkshire. But they're both fossils. Sorry, they're not both fossils. They're both coral. One is fossilized, one isn't. But you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, I don't even know what I'm doing. Now I feel like I'm on a kids' show, which I think was probably your intention all along. But like,
it's great. No, I want this.
it's like, you know, this is what I spend my days and nights trying to like get my head around how these are both creatures.
Yeah.
And like this one is ancient and this one, you know, is it like the thing about finding this on the Thames foreshore is that it's really in the wrong place, right?
So yeah.
Colonialism totally displaced this, you know, it was probably already dead. It was probably on a beach, but totally displaced this creature like through wind and a sailing
ship. Yeah.
Right. And because ballast is what sits in a ship underwater.
Yeah.
To counter the pressure of the wind. I don't know. It just
it's a lot.
I can't stop thinking about it. It does my head in.
Yeah, that's it's really a lot. Like it's I don't know, just thinking of and the fact that it's this non-human entity that's had this massive journey through wind, through colonialism. And I'm never going to stop getting over how old that the fossil is as well.
Yeah.
I have a friend who she'll be annoyed if she knows I'm saying this, but she always weeps when she sees cave paintings. She goes to see a lot of caves, and she just can't. It makes her cry just talking about it, like to think of how far back in time the cave paintings were made, like how long ago. And I'm really, my sense of time and space is very poor, so for me I weep at her weeping, but I don't have that sense. But the idea of you holding this, I can't even remember the number of million year old.
340 million.
My mind, right? It's just that doesn't seem real. Doesn't seem
right.
Allowed. But oh, can you hear that? Lovely. Though, do you know what that means?
I think so.
I think it means it's time for our first segment. Are you ready for this? That was a little segment called Show Your Pets the Weather, the part of the show where you, the public, get to join in the fun of showing your beloved pets the weather. Thank you so much to everyone who showed pet videos to me this week. I have watched and loved every single one of them. JR, do you have a pet?
I had a dog when I lived in Montreal, and actually wrote an entire novel called Words the Dog Knows. One of the words that the dog knows was phenomenology, because when the wind happens, it happens in the ears. Yeah. And when thunder happens, it happens in the heart, you know? So yeah, pet, having a pet is like a whole other relationship with weather.
Yeah, it's, yeah, I guess, and with a dog, you just have to like expose yourself to the elements constantly, right? Because you, they have to be allowed outside.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Oh, I think that little meow there means it might be time for our next segment. Are you ready for one more?
Absolutely.
Okay.
I like my pet, you like your pets, let's like our pets together. And now it's time to show my pets your pets being shown the weather.
So to be clear about what's happening here, this is my pet, Cha-u, being shown your pet being shown the weather. And I think she's about to have an icy moment. Yep, we made a whole segment for that. Yep, that was Show My Pets, Your Pets Being Shown the Weather, the part of the show where my pets slash movie stars and your pets slash movie stars collide. Again, if you want my pets to meet your pets, to send in your vids, the email address is info@ourangel.org.uk. Tune in next week to see if your pet has made it to the big screen. Yeah, Cha-u, it's like the first time she's ever engaged with the TV in that way before, where she just sat and watched it and it kind of was fooled by it, and then she got so embarrassed, which is also a really adorable thing to see a cat do. But she, her own relationship with her with the screen has had, she just started to see it like a window, whereas when I started filming this project maybe 2 years ago, she didn't have that that sense yet.
Yeah, there was, I can't remember what it was now, but there was something that my dog would respond to if he heard it on television.
Yeah.
That he would think it was a real thing. Yeah.
Yeah, we used to leave on, I had a dog in the period where that TV show or film, I can't remember, Walking with Dinosaurs was very popular in the 2000s. And there used to be this accompanying information channel, if you press the red button on the BBC, where you could watch watch like behind the scenes of this Walking with Dinosaurs documentary. And we'd just leave it on for him when we went out, and we'd come back and he'd still be watching these CGI dinosaurs. And really, like, it was, I think, a testament to them getting the animation right, that he really believed in it. He loved those dinosaurs.
I think it maybe was clapping. My dog believed all applause was for him. And if there was applause on television, he'd be like,
Oh, my audience are here. Hi. Don't mind if I do.
I don't know where he got that from.
Yeah, it's so sweet. It's been actually really nice. When I first started filming, as I said, the cats didn't really have a relationship with film, but on Tuesday when Rain came out, Lola and I watched it together, and she watched it from start to finish, like absolutely mesmerized. And she recognized herself on screen, or at least recognized the catness of herself. Every time she came on, she kind of poked her little head up and kept coming closer to the screen. And it was really nice to see as well, like all the bits where I'd filmed the rain for ages that she really loved to watch. Like, she'd come in every day while we were shooting and outside of shooting as well, and kind of poke her head into the boxes that word design and sort of say, well, I would like to watch the cat TV now. And so it's nice to be able to continue doing that. I've had a few comments from people already that they've watched it with their cats and they've also reacted quite positively to it. So maybe a future in cat-based filmmaking for me. We have some questions from the audience. Would you like to answer some questions?
Absolutely.
Incredible. So question for JR, what are some of the other strange things you found while mudlarking?
Well, creatures, you know, like I found a fossilized shark's tooth. Mm-hmm. And I found, I don't know, this might be one of my favorite things I found recently, a piece of a fossilized spine of a sea urchin, but like a kind of sea urchin that has really long spines. So they're called pencil sea urchins, like the contemporary cousins. But it's like a tiny thing like that. And you think, you know, what even is that? But I knew it was something. So I get excited about those kind of things. Recently, I found some dice, but like tiny, tiny, hundreds and hundreds of years old. But they're made of bone, you know, and possibly antler. So there's still this kind of creature in there.
That's great. That's really mesmerizing as well. Like just the idea of dice made of antler, like the long history of the object that came into your hand on the Thames foreshore. That's crazy.
Yeah, I mean, I found some crazy things and I'm really interested in how, where they come from. Again, like, because I think about the weather and research the weather, I'm thinking about like, well, did this come here on a ship or like what, you know? So I found a lot of stuff that even though it's really, really old, it came on a ship a long time ago.
Yeah. So it's it was an antiquity that came on a ship.
Yeah, or was meant to go on a ship. So one thing I found that is really haunting is a Hudson's Bay Company trade bead.
Yeah.
So the Hudson's Bay Company was fur traders. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I grew up in Canada and the impact that the Hudson's Bay Company has had on the Indigenous peoples of North America is devastating. I mean, it was basically genocidal. And what they took to trade for these pelts were these tiny little beads that they bought in bulk from Venice. So they were like brought to London and then from London brought to North America to be traded for pelts. And just like, yeah, so tiny, tiny thing like that. And the one I found was a bit crushed even, but like the ramifications of that thing. Massive.
I think it's, you've done such a great job of capturing like these tiny micro objects that have this like huge journey and the way, I don't know, where we're zooming out and we're just surrounded by so much stuff now. There's so much stuff and then there's you shed back a few layers and that stuff is all there lying in the Thames. It's crazy.
Like what you said earlier about the consumer waste and our stupid headphones or lack thereof now, you know, and everybody's the iconic thing that people associate with mudlarking are the clay pipes. But
yeah,
we find hundreds.
I even found some clay pipes.
But like we also find hundreds of disposable vapes.
Oh, God.
Yeah. Right? And so you just think, well, that's never going to go away.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Right? And we find cigarette butts, like cigarette butts, whatever they're made of, are one of the biggest plastic pollutions in the world.
Yeah. It's terrifying. I don't know what you do with that, because I like to think that there's a future where someone finds a vape on the foreshore and they come and they're like, mommy, look what I found. It's a vape. But I don't see it. I don't believe that future. I don't believe it. I bought this fruit machine for, not a fruit machine, like an animatronic machine full of, it was bears, talking bears that laid a prize egg and the egg was full of like toys the bears tell a joke. I'm doing a really bad job of explaining this machine. The bear tells a joke, the other bear laughs, and then they give you a toy egg, and it's a game from an arcade in the 80s, and I used it for a project called Crip Casino, which had all these little prizes in it that were kind of meant to be a bit crap. And they had all inside, when I started opening the eggs to see what was there that it remained from the 80s, loads of them were made of rubber, and the rubber had started to melt, and you could smell the latex. And just opening them, like this, I had to start wearing gloves to open these machine, and thinking about these kids' toys that are disintegrating and breaking down in your hands, it was horrifying.
I recently found a vulcanite bottle stopper.
Yeah.
Near you as well. And vulcanite, like vulcanized rubber, was the technique that made rubber stop disintegrating.
Yeah. Right.
But like rubber is something that we have through colonialism. And it was all brought on sailing ships, and also clay pipes, you know, tobacco is indigenous to Great Turtle Island, right? North America. Like it didn't exist here before these sailing ships were coming out of the Thames and going over and bringing this stuff back. So when you start to sort of look through the layers and you see it's all weather and colonial violence.
and the fact that that's still rippling on, it and hasn't been resolved really. It's still an ongoing conversation. What is going to happen? It's just going to get it. I don't know. It just feels some of the problems that humanity has created, especially white humanity, I don't know what you do with. Sometimes it feels so big that how do you move on from? That's just me getting overwhelmed for a moment. But it's sometimes, I think it is helpful to sometimes sit and reflect the like horror of it and think, well, how do we start? We start with small. It has to be small and small steps in our own worlds, as well as big policy change that we need to be fighting for. I have some other questions before I talk myself into a hole. A question for JR and Abby, that's both of us, from Mary Patterson. Do either of you have favorite myths and legends around concepts like clouds, space, and weather, physical or digital?
Whoa, that's a great question.
It's a really great question. I don't know if I have an answer off the top of my head.
Well, yeah, I mean, so this is timely because I've just finally been reading that fantastic translation of the Odyssey by, what is it, Emily Wilson, first woman to translate the Odyssey. And it's
incredible.
Full of wind, right? Because it's an oceanic story, and it's really amazing. Like, wind is like a really active player in the thing. It's not just passive. It's not just like and the people aren't controlling the wind. The wind is controlling the people. So yeah, that has is really standing out for me. And water, Poseidon is also a god. So they're using gods for these things, but it's a really interesting kind of like the elemental is before the human action. And that text has been with us for thousands of years and is really instrumental to how we think, or it's really formative to how we think. But I think we've forgotten a lot of that. Like we think we've invented the weather. We think that we've invented rubberized Macintoshes, and you know, we've used all of this technology to sort of not be so driven by the weather anymore. But when you start to read things like Greek epic poetry or these mythological stories, you realize that they're large. They're sort of constructs in a way for making sense of things like the weather, which are bigger than us.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's so beautiful. it's so beautiful, isn't it, to think of how over time, like this sport, it I think that is something that defines the modern era, maybe, that like we've spent more time. I don't know, I'm riffing this thought out, maybe it isn't real and maybe I'll sound like an idiot, but like the idea of the more control we think we can have over the elements, rather than telling stories to find ways to navigate them and make sense of them, I think that it's a different kind of story, isn't it? The story we're telling at the moment is about stuff and like the more things you have, the more protected you are from these forces. But like this idea of evading first of all of chill, then death, you know, like if we just surround ourselves with more and more walls and more stuff, we're protected from these elements, and then we don't need to try to understand them, and we laugh at stories. Oh, that's a meow. That it might be time for our last question, or I think we have maybe time for one more. Oh, they're all very complicated. If you're a question to Abby, a question for Abby, I'll do this as a very quick one because I think we do have to wrap up. But what have Cha-u and Lola Lola made of their big screen debuts this week? Lola was very mesmerized by her own presence on the screen. That's certainly something that happened. And Cha-u, she's more of a coy cat, so her favorite part of the project has been the fact that I've stayed up very late to work on it, so that means she can sit on my head, which she is her favorite thing to do, or on my shoulders, and sort of bend me into a slightly different position. That's her favorite thing, so she's enjoyed that I haven't been sleeping so well because I've been excited. And in that, we all got something. They don't like my outfit today, I can tell you that. They think it's strange. They might not be entirely wrong. Thank you so much to everyone who sent questions in. Just a reminder, if you want to catch up on my film series, Abi Palmer Invents the Weather, episode one is out right now, and as you might have gathered, it's all about rain. You can watch it right here on our Angels YouTube channel. New episodes are being released every Tuesday for the rest of March. Next Tuesday we'll be back with episode two, and it's all about fog. Lost my auto cue. If you're wondering how I'm doing this excellent talking, I do have an auto cue in front of me. Then join us next week for the after party every Thursday, 7 p.m. Greenwich Mean Time, right on this couch. Next week we'll be joined by two of my favorite artists and humans, Stop and Dre Spistow, to talk about fog, isolation, and building dens. A den of one's own. I keep thinking about that, like having a den of one's own and what that means. I don't know. I don't have an answer yet. Hopefully by next week, maybe I will. Come and join us. Don't forget to tell all of your friends, and don't forget to show your pets the weather. I want to say some thank yous. Thank you so much to Art Angel for commissioning this project, and thank you to Tank TV for hosting it on their channel over March. Thank you, Marina Doritas and Michael Morris, for their excellent production, and thank you to Lily Max Hager for her incredible tech support and the making of pet show reels. I think perhaps that might be the best art I've ever seen, so I'm very, very grateful. A very big thank you to Mia Maxwell for styling my gorgeous outfit today, and Faye Carla for making up my beautiful face. And my cat collaborators, they were very rude, so we don't need to thank them at all. But I do want to say a big thank you to the audience for tuning in, and a massive, massive thank you to our special guest, JR Carpenter, for this incredible conversation. So thank you so much, JR. It's been so great to chat a little bit longer. And as ever, I wish we could talk some more.
We will.
Yeah. Where can the audience find more about your work?
My website is luckysoap.com.
That's very easy to remember, the luckiest soap of them all. Join us next week. I'm your host, Abi Palmer, and this has been The Weather. Goodbye.